Good morning, church family. It is wonderful to be here this morning and a privilege to be presiding in worship today. This is Lord's Day, the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Looking at the world around me this week, I started thinking about how lucky we are to have this community, to have a community of faith, a family of faith to be part of. You know, I mean, you look at all the things happening around us, and I think we just all need all the community, all the support, all the caring we can get these days. So that's what we want to be. We want to be that caring, supportive community, a loving community of faithful people surrounding each other. So, and that's the family, the kind of family we are. So if you would help us with that by making sure you wear your name tag so everyone knows who you are, and filling out your Connect card in the bulletin. It's purple today. Online, welcome online, and yours is connected to the page that you're looking at there. You can go ahead and click on that and fill that out. That would be great. That'll help us out. Also, updating your picture in the directory is a wonderful thing too. There are a couple things that I want to make sure you see today. One is the clouds in your bulletin. The Holy Spirit is our theme today. Except it would take about an hour or an hour and a half to preach through all these scriptures on the Holy Spirit. So I decided to go a different direction, let you read these, and I'm going to talk about my experience of the Holy Spirit today. I thought that was probably a good way to go. So we'll be doing that. While we're doing that, of course, the Articles of Religion. We're holding the Articles of Religion in one hand and the Bible in the other. They're back on the table with the name tags if you haven't picked one up yet. It's really interesting to read through those, and that's what we're working on today. Number 4 and number 8. Also today, we have some representatives from our upcoming mission trip. Next Sunday morning, the youth will be leaving on a mission trip to Colorado, and we want to be blessing them this morning. As part of that blessing, I would like us to use some scriptures, and I'd like you to pick the scriptures. So I have about 20 of these folders that have 12 scriptures in them, I think it is, and I'm just going to pass them out, and if you're willing to read a scripture while we're gathered together, just as we're gathered together, everybody, just read one. That'd be great. Whatever scripture happens to move you. These are the copies that are going to go to, these are scriptures that are going to go with the youth on the mission trip, and I encourage you, even if you don't want to read, take one, because they're dated, and you can read a scripture each day of the next 2 weeks while they're preparing and while they're gone on the mission trip as well. So, if you're online, go ahead and offer your joys and concerns, because there's a lag. Most of us don't realize it, but there is a lag between online and here, and by the time you put your joys and concerns in, I might be kneeling down at the rail and praying already. So put those in now so that we have those. Connecting with each other as family, that's such an important part of who we are. But in worship, what we're about is connecting with God. That's really what we're here for today. I was thinking this week, maybe one of the most important purposes of worship right now is just to get people to sit down and be quiet for an hour so they can listen to God. So let's do that. Let's sit, be silent, listen for God's voice as the Holy Spirit speaks to us in preparation for worship today. Thank you.
When the world divides. When the world calls us orphaned.
Come, Holy Spirit, make us family.
When the world leads us astray.
Come, Holy Spirit, call us home. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come and fill this place.
You may be seated. And we'll read in unison our first article of faith, Article 4. Concerning the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Ghost, proceeding from the Father and the Son, is of one substance, majesty, and glory with the Father and the Son, very and eternal God.
Article 8, when I was working with it this week, it is almost incomprehensible. If you look at it in your bulletin there, you look at it on the screen, the sentence structure, the order of the words is just very different from what we are accustomed to. So I think reading it together would just be a jumble of words. So I have tried to correct the sentence structure a little bit, keep the same words and correct the sentence structure. So the original is going to be on the screen, but I'm going to read you my revised standard version of that particular article. The condition of man after the fall of Adam is such that he cannot of himself turn to faith by calling upon God by his own natural strength or works. Therefore, we have no power to do good works that are pleasant and acceptable to God, unless the grace of God by Christ goes ahead of us that we may have good will and are working with us that we may have that good will. We have an opportunity to share our joys and our concerns with one another this morning. One of my joys, what a great turnout from our friends from New Hope today. Glad to see all of you, just almost filling a pew back there if you put you all together, so that's good. What other joys do you have today that you'd like to lift up? Did anybody else get cupcakes and cookies yesterday? Yeah? That's a joy, isn't it? And on top of that, they raised a bunch of money for the Boers. And the t-shirt sales went well, so there are a lot of ways that we're trying to support the Boers in this time of difficulty, and I'm glad that you guys are being part of that. And I see Amy's with us today, along with Jeff. Glad to have you with us, that you're feeling able to be here today. What a joy it is to have you. She's kind of on vacation right now, but it's not a lot of a vacation. But she's between treatments right now. So she'll be starting again the 19th of July. So keep her in prayer. Keep the family in prayer. What else do you have today that you'd like to lift up?
The Hestons have a couple of announcements. Barb Heston's birthday was on Tuesday, so happy birthday to Barb.
Happy birthday.
Sorry, Wednesday. Tuesday she had eye surgery, mm-hmm. and it went well, and she's waiting until, like, I believe it's the 17th for the second one, and she's still waiting for August to hear about her other things that she needs.
Cancer. Okay. Very good. So we want to, you could all hear that. I don't have to repeat that one, I guess. Remember the Hestons, I keep reminding you because I'm not sure if you have figured out who they are yet. That's Noah's other grandparents. So we lift them up in prayer. They're regulars with us every Sunday. And I think Jackie needs prayers as much as John does. She's very nervous about this, but that's understandable. It's a scary thing. So John will be having his heart mapped, they call it, next Monday, again, in preparation for an open heart surgery, working on some valves. Later on this summer, so keep them in prayer. They probably won't be here next week, it sounds like, so lift them up in prayer. Lloyd Klein, since we spoke last time, Lloyd Klein was in the hospital and he's out. Mrs. Norgard was in the hospital last I knew. I don't know that she's been released. Sally, there we go. Sally. Lloyd's back at Regency. If there's nothing else this morning, would you allow me to lead you in prayer? Holy and merciful God, how could we be anywhere but here this morning? Some of us are drawn by music composed to express our human response to the mystery of your love. Some of us have come to confess our complicity or involvement or our responsibility for injustice and suffering or broken hearts. Some of us have come because over the years we've made a habit of being here on Sunday. And some have come, especially today, to say thank you for what is good for today. Oh God, gather up all the reasons that we are here. Gather them all up in your great love. We thank you, O God, for all the blessings of our lives, for the love of friends and family, for a beautiful world, for art, for music to express our deepest gratitude. We thank you for our nation, which we celebrated this week, and we ask you to be with and bless the men and women who lead us. We thank you for your church, holy and universal, which worships you today in so many different ways around the world. Bless your church, O God. Make it an instrument of your love and reconciliation so that the hope of salvation and the hope of future glory will be spread through all the world and your love will be known to all. O God, we pray for peace in the world, peace wherever there is violence, particularly in the Middle East, in Africa, here in our own country, in our community, in our homes. We pray for our peace, for the peace that passes understanding, the peace of heart that knows that in your love there is no reason to be afraid. We pray, O God, for all those who suffer this day. Be with the poor and the oppressed, the sick and the lonely, the frightened and the bereaved. Surround them with encouraging love. We pray for families this day, new families and families who've been together for many years, families with new babies, some of which are just what they hoped for, others who have serious medical conditions. May those babies be loved with your care and given the best treatment available to them. For families separated by work, by travel, by illness, by anger, by failure. For families who live in the same house but are further apart than if they lived on separate coasts. For families dealing with addictions and those celebrating years of sobriety or even days of sobriety. Oh God, we offer all of our families to you in all their complexity and all of their beauty. Oh God, we stand beneath your cross today. We stand beneath your cross. Kindle in us a new faith, a new love, a new courage, a new resolve to live our lives worthy of your love that you have given us in Jesus Christ. Bring us through the dark nights and the difficult days so that we can receive the light and hope and joy of your resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I wonder if those who are going on the mission trip would just step into the middle aisle at this time. Lord, we offer you all these people who are going on mission trip this week, all 8 or 9 of them. We give you thanks for their willingness, for the time that they're giving, for the energy that they're giving, for the hope that they're going to give those people they meet this week. We pray for open hearts, for open minds, for open hands as they reach out to the people in Colorado. Fill them with grace and with your love so that they will be a reflection of all that you want to be for these people. Give them energy, give them safety as they travel and as they work. And all the other groups that are joining them, we pray for them as well. Lord, we give you thanks that we are able to participate in this mission in this way, and we send our representatives on our behalf. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Our scripture comes from Romans 8, 1 through 17. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, then the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. So then, brothers and sisters, we are obligated not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you will be put to death, you will put to death the deeds of the body and you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If we in fact suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him.
I want to introduce you to our guest today. Our guest is a friend whom I've known for a very long time. We go way back. Our guest has been like GPS for my life, even before GPS was invented, going with me around all the twists and turns and corners of life. Our guest has taught me more than I could ever imagine anybody else teaching me, particularly about hope. I've struggled a lot with hope in my life, and I wrote my senior seminar paper in college about the theology of hope as I struggled with that, but I didn't really know hope until I experienced it because of our guest today. And I have to say that I am who I am largely because of what this person has made me. And what I do as a pastor, largely I do because of this person. And when I'm not quite sure how to lead the church, I'm not quite sure how to work with someone, I ask, what would our guests do? Now, maybe you know our guests already, but if not, it's worth some time at least reflecting on how the Holy Spirit works in your life. Our guest today is the Holy Spirit, and I'm standing here because I wanted all the people online to see the beautiful graphic that they're building for us. We see the dove and the dove up there as a representative of the Holy Spirit and the heart for God and the cross for Christ and the triangle for the Trinity, and it's turning out to be a really neat graphic. I can't wait to see what they do with it next. So we are in the fourth sermon in this series on faith roots. And this series of sermons is a series where we're looking at the roots of our faith, the very core beliefs that we have. And in order to do that, we're holding the Articles of Religion of the Methodist Church in one hand, and those articles are the ones you'll find in the back, along with the Articles of Faith of the Evangelical United Brethren Church, John Wesley's 52 Sermons, and John Wesley's Explanatory Notes of the New Testament. That makes up one side of the triangle. When we talk about Wesley's Quadrilateral, that makes up the tradition side of the triangle. And over the course, in the other hand, we're holding Scripture, which makes up another side of the triangle. And we put those two together and we reflect on our experiences with our minds to make the other two sides of the triangle, trying to illuminate these common beliefs that we have so that we can understand them better and we can share them with others. This week, we're talking about two different articles. I'm going to start with Article 8. And this is the article on free will. This is the one that I said is almost incomprehensible, and it's really unfortunate because it helps us understand what is something that's distinctively Wesleyan, something that's distinctively different about what we believe from what other people believe. So my summary of this one, it says two things, basically. First, it says, sin makes us powerless to do the right thing on our own. Paul says in Romans 7:19, for I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep doing. We can all relate to that, can't we? We are powerless to do the right thing on our own. And second, the second part of it is God in Christ or the Holy Spirit is always working in us to influence our desires and our intention, our decisions toward good. Let me take that apart for you. The first thing is we have free will. I think we could all probably agree on that because you can decide what you're going to have for lunch today. We can't decide what the future is going to be, but we can decide what today is going to be. We can decide what right now is going to be. Unlike a robot or a squirrel that lives mostly on instinct, we have free will. We can think. We can decide for ourselves. We can decide if we're going to eat the fruit of the tree of good and evil, or are we going to fast that day? We can decide if we're going to rob a quick shop or if we're going to read our Bible that day. We can decide between God and something other than God. And that's really where this comes down to. Our daily decisions is one thing, but when we start talking about people being able to decide to push God away, that's when the doctrine of free will really becomes important. It says that as we come to faith, we have the ability to say no to God. We have the ability to push God away and refuse God's presence and God's work in our lives. And that is very different from some of our Christian brothers and sisters. This comes from John Wesley, of course, but Jacob Arminius is one of the first people who started talking about this, because our experience is that we have this free will, and our experience is that we can make this decision. Any day, any time, we could choose, I hope we don't, but we could choose to say no to God. Any day we could choose to do that, or any time we could choose to do that. That's not what God wants. But God has given us that ability because to worship, to love someone is a voluntary thing. It's not something that we can force someone to do. We're not forced to love God. We're not forced to be here. We're not forced to believe. We're given that opportunity. We have the free will to choose or not choose. And the second thing about that is that our free will is bent toward ourselves. Some say we're bent towards sin, but I don't think that's quite right. I don't think I'm bent toward doing evil. I'm bent toward doing things that are selfish. I'm bent toward doing the easy thing. I'm bent toward doing the convenient thing. And I think I'm bent toward doing the greedy thing. And I think that's where a lot of the sin comes from. That my free will is twisted. It's bent that direction. It's bent toward me. And we can't change that on our own because it's bent toward us. How can we possibly change that? Well, we can't. But the next part of this doctrine is that God is always working in us. God is always working in us to help us bend our will the other direction. God is always working in us to influence our desires and our decisions toward God rather than toward ourselves. Now, this means that even before you believe, even before you're aware of God, when you're when you're in your mother's womb, when you're a child, before you even know the name of God, God is working in you to bend you toward God. God is working in you to make you try to get you to come this direction. Not forcing you, enticing you, shaping you, molding you. And we call that prevenient grace. Prevenient grace. And that word prevenient is not one that we use very often for anything else, actually. But if you think about intervening, when we step in the middle of something, to prevene is to go before something. So God is going before us, drawing us to God. And that's what prevenient grace is all about. We can't by ourselves come to God. God comes to us, and it's, I've used the image, and I'm not sure it's a great image, but it's like, you know, we can stand with our foot against the door. And when we decide not to fight God, when we decide not to fight God, not to push God away, then God can work in us. But it's that prevenient grace is always encouraging us and drawing us closer to God. And that's a distinctive, important doctrine for Wesleyan Methodists. It's very different from some of the other doctrines that other churches hold. And for instance, the Calvinists, and that would be the Presbyterian tradition, the Calvinists believe in irresistible grace. That means that I can't refuse God's grace. We don't have the power to refuse that. And that's just not my experience. That's just not the way I experience God. So it makes more sense to me look at this free will. And it also sets us up to have a God that, you know, how do you explain that some people aren't saved? If God's will, God's grace is irresistible, if God's will is irresistible, how do you explain those people who aren't saved? And I've never figured that out, because that would mean that God doesn't want to save everybody. And I need a Calvinist friend to explain that to me, and I've never understood it. But by believing prevenient grace, by being Arminian, believing in free will, we're very different from those Calvinists. And there's nothing wrong with either side. It's the way we experience it and the way that we understand our faith. So we have this first important part is that we have free will, we're bent toward ourselves, God's always working in us, even before we know it, to bend us toward God. And God working in us, that's the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit working in us to bend us toward God. Before we even know it, the Holy Spirit is working in our lives. We did not receive a spirit of adoption. We did not receive a spirit of fear. We received a spirit of adoption, so that when we cry, Abba, Father, it is the Spirit in us that bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. When we finally come to that point, when we cry, Father, I believe, it is the Spirit in us, the Spirit that's been working in us, the Spirit that's been changing us and molding us, that assures us that we are children of God. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. That second article says, it talks about our experience of the Holy Spirit. Our experience is formative and transformative. Those are my words. The doctrine actually says the Holy Ghost proceeding from the Father and the Son is of one substance, majesty, and glory with the Father and the Son, very and eternal God. It is this persistent, prevenient grace, this persistent presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives that characterizes my experience of the Holy Spirit. Now, to be clear, this doctrine is very clear that there is one God. Okay, the Holy Ghost proceeds from the Father and the Son is of one substance, majesty and glory. One substance, one majesty, one glory. There are not three gods. The Holy Spirit is not part of God. They are one and the same. There are three ways of understanding what God is doing in our lives: Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is the same God that was pre-existent and eternally existent. The Holy Spirit swept across the faces of the deep in creation, just as in John 1, the Son was there speaking the words of creation. And of course, the Father was there. When Moses' face shone with the Shekinah of God because he stood in front of God, it was the Holy Spirit that shone through his face. It was the Word of God that he received that day. It was the presence of the Father. All three at the same time, in the same place, that made that experience. In Jesus' baptism, the Father, of course, was there speaking the words. The dove comes down representing the Holy Spirit. The Son, of course, was there being baptized. All the same. One God, one place. One God. When Jesus performed his miraculous healings and giving of hope to people, it was Jesus and the Holy Spirit that he gave to people and God the Father working together, all one, one God in one place, doing that work. Now, we could go on and talk about the other things the Holy Spirit does, but I put them on that sheet. Rather than taking 2 hours to preach all of those things today, I thought I'd give those to you. That's your homework this week, to go home, read those, and maybe I've forgotten some. If I've forgotten some, if I've missed some, let me know. I'd be glad to hear some more. It's just more work for the confirmands when they come this year. The rest of the sermon, I want to just share with you not doctrine so much as my experience. How do I feel the Holy Spirit? How do I know the Holy Spirit in my life? Now, you hear the word spirit a lot. If you watch TV, all those ghost shows on, you hear spirits a lot, and you hear a lot about them, but that's different from what we're talking about. They talk about spirits making things cold and sucking energy out of rooms and being invisible, kind of faded and lifeless. But that's not at all what the Holy Spirit is like. The Holy Spirit, as I see it, is more like school spirit or national spirit or Christmas spirit. It's not spirit that takes things away from us, but spirit that fills us, spirit that gives us something, spirit that gives us life. When you go to a pep rally, you don't go to a pep rally and have the energy sucked out of you. You go to the pep rally and have the energy put into you. That's what the Holy Spirit does. That's the way I experience the Holy Spirit, is it's a filling. It's not an emptying. It's a filling. And that's very important to me. The Hebrew and Greek of the word sanctus, which is spirit, spiritus, which is spirit, they both reflect the wind. They can be wind or breath. And that image of the wind is so important to me in the Holy Spirit. That's the way I experience the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit does not sit still in my life. The Holy Spirit is not stationary in my life. The Holy Spirit is always moving, always blowing through my life like the wind. And I think of the rocks at the Grand Canyon or the Red Rocks in outside of Colorado Springs, where the wind has shaped the rocks. Over thousands and millions of years, the wind blowing on these rocks, the sand blowing against these rocks, has shaped them and formed them and sometimes made little holes in them and sometimes made them round and sometimes given them amazing shapes. That's the way the Holy Spirit works in my life, blowing through me, eroding away the parts that are dark and revealing the parts that are beautiful, taking away the parts that are doubting and moving those somewhere else, but then revealing a new gift. A new insight, a new experience, a new power. That's the way the Holy Spirit works in my life. Doesn't sit still. The Holy Spirit is always moving, always acting, always changing. The Holy Spirit is always working in my life to form me more in the image of God, to transform me more into the image of God. The Holy Spirit, it's always eroding away doubt and exposing new faith. And I recognize the Holy Spirit in things like music. When your heart quickens as the music is played. I recognize the Holy Spirit in nature. When suddenly I'm aware of God's presence moving in me as I watch a sunset or I listen to the babbling brook. Those are the places when I experience the Holy Spirit most. He's always there. But it reminds me of the presence of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is always moving forward, always moving me forward, filling my sails, if you will, as the wind fills the sails on a sailboat, always move me forward from darkness to light, from brokenness to wholeness, from the same old, to the new and the bold, from being just a little too realistic to being willing to consider miracles. It's the Holy Spirit that fills us and moves us into this new way of looking at the world and the new way of looking at life, and sometimes pushes us out of our comfort zone. That's the problem with the Holy Spirit. Sometimes it pushes us out of our comfort zone, but never abandons us in those new places. Sometimes it's scary, sometimes it's difficult, but it's not impossible, because all things are possible with God. The Holy Spirit speaks to me through the tears of a child, through the dreams, the tired old dreams of an old man, through the broken hearts, through the fear of those around me, as I see God moving in their lives. The Holy Spirit moves in me and makes me sad sometimes, as I become aware of places where I've harmed someone and not even known it, where I've done wrong and not even been aware of it until later on, perhaps, or maybe, you know, it's time to go make that apology that none of us like to make. That's the Holy Spirit working in me. It's the Holy Spirit that, when I get ready to step into the ICU room with someone who's just hanging on to life, it's the Holy Spirit that quickens my heart to be able to do that. When I get ready to step into the pulpit, it's the Holy Spirit that quickens my heart to be able to give me the words and give me the energy to be able to do what needs to be done to speak the Word of God. And you know what? The amazing thing about preaching is the Holy Spirit also works in you. Because even as I speak, some of you are hearing different words. The words that the Spirit needs you to hear. And every once in a while I get an insight into that when someone says, "I'm so glad you talked about this today." And I'm thinking to myself, "I didn't say anything about that." But it's sincerely what they heard by the Holy Spirit. Your specifics may be different. Your details could be vastly different from mine. But I think the basics are the same. I think the Holy Spirit is always moving in your life if you can just become aware of it. Always changing you if you can just become aware of it. Always molding you if you can just see it. Always drawing you close to God if you can just feel it. It's breath. We breathe in the Holy Spirit and we breathe out. And we breathe in. May the Spirit of God go with you always. And we breathe out. And we breathe in. And we breathe out. May you be filled with the Holy Spirit of the living God as you breathe in and as you breathe out. And as you breathe in, may the Holy Spirit take you wherever you go. Amen. Go now. May you be filled with the Holy Spirit as a balloon is filled with helium. May you float in the presence of God. May you share the love of God and the light of God and the hope of God with all those around you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.